ओके फिर स्टार्ट। वेरी गुड इवनिंग डॉक्टर्स, ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ हार्मोनिका एक्यूमेंटिस आई एम प्रतीक फ्रॉम मार्केटिंग टीम एज वेल एज फ्रॉम सेल्स टीम। वी वुड लाइक टू वेलकम ऑल द डेलीगेट्स एंड अवर टूडेज रिनॉन स्पीकर डॉक्टर अंजू जैन। डॉक्टर अंजू जैन इज डायरेक्टर जैन हॉस्पिटल वाराणसी, डीजीओ गोल्ड मेडलिस्ट डीएनबी, डिप्लोमा हॉस्पिटल मैनेजमेंट एनआईएच एफडब्ल्यू, एक सीनियर गायनेकोलॉजिस्ट पीटी डीडीओ डिस्ट्रिक्ट हॉस्पिटल वाराणसी, साइंटिफिक सेक्रेटरी सर एंड आईएसपीएटी 2019। शी वाज द एक्स सोशल सेक्रेटरी एंड जॉइंट साइंटिफिक सेक्रेटरी बीओजीएस। देन शी वाज द ट्रेजरर एसएफएम यूपी चैप्टर 21-22, रेसिपिएंट ऑफ अप्रिसिएशन अवार्ड बाय आईएमए वाराणसी। देन रिसीव अप्रिसिएशन अवार्ड फॉर कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन इन प्रधानमंत्री सुरक्षित मैत्रित्व अभियान। FMF certified for NT-NB scan and conducted various conferences and workshops in fetal medicine and laparoscopy in association with VOGS. Welcome, Doctor.
Thank you, Pratik.
Yeah.
Thank you, Harmonica. Thank you, Pankaji, for giving me this opportunity to interact with our renowned friends. And if I could help them in learning some of the tips of ultrasound, or I can develop them for ultrasound, it will be an honor for me. So continuing the previous series, we discussed the NT scan in previously. Now in continuation of that, we will be discussing how to do a normal targeted imaging, fetal imaging, at in second trimester or even in first trimester, which should everyone should target to learn. So without wasting much of the time, let's start with the presentation. And I would really appreciate if you have any problem anytime, please let me know. I will stop in between and we can start it again. Or anything which is not understandable, please let me know. I'll explain it again. My screen is visible, I think.
Yes,
yeah, madam, your screen is visible. Can you please make it in a...
I was just doing that.
And you can press F5 also directly.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
Now it's okay, na?
Yeah. Yes, perfect.
So a targeted anomaly scan or a targeted imaging for fetal anomalies, which we normally call by TIFA scan. So what are the objectives of a TIFA scan or an anomaly scan? It is to detect congenital anomalies, either chromosomal or structural both, to assess fetal growth, and for accurate determination of gestational age, fetal number, cardiac activity, placental localization, and lighter volume. Though if we have done an early scan, we have already ascertained her gestational age, we have ascertained her LMP. If she is not sure of her LMP, her gestational age has already been ascertained, we don't change it again. We have already done fetal number. If it is the first scan the woman is undergoing, then definitely this plays an important role, determination of gestational age, fetal number, and cardiac activity. In each and every scan, first of all, we have to ensure that the baby is alive. Then we progress forward further. So we look for the placental localization and Likert volume. Then after doing a scan, we have to help the couple on making a decision if there is an abnormality detected, if whether it is a major anomaly or a minor anomaly, correctable anomaly or an uncorrectable anomaly, and if termination of pregnancy has to be done or has to be advised, it should be in accordance with the PNDT law, and it should not be like haphazardly. You cannot do that. Okay. So, and if there is any help which we can do the parents by doing any in utero intervention, that can be explained, that has to be explained to the patient, to the parents. And if there is a need of timely referral, then we have to do that. Okay. So, what is the timing? We all know that we usually do it at 18 to 20 weeks time, but now, always try to do an anomaly scan at first visit, like at 12 to 13 weeks, so that major anomalies, not to be missed anomalies, we can pick at 12 to 13 weeks only. Though it has a limitation, we can detect up to 50 to 60% of the anomalies at 12 to 13 weeks itself. And accordingly, the timing can be adjusted according to the history of the woman. If there is a high risk behavior, like if she had a history of a previous baby delivering a previous baby with a congenital heart disease or a neurocentral nervous system anomaly, then we can do a anomaly scan at 16 weeks also, and we can repeat it after 2 weeks again. Or if there is any abnormal marker in first trimester, like if the NTNB scan shows increased nuchal translucency, reversal of DV flow or tricuspid regurgitation, and if we have done a combined screening which shows it is a low risk for Down syndrome, then we should definitely call that woman after 2 weeks, around 16 weeks, to rule out cardiac anomalies. We have to see for all the bones. Though skeletal dysplasia is not possible at this time, but at least we measure all the bones and we follow up that baby to rule out skeletal dysplasias later. And what should be the approach? It should be a very systematic approach, no haphazard way. And we should follow a guideline. Whatever guideline you choose, no matter, but follow a proper guideline and always try to have a checklist. Stick a checklist in front of you in the ultrasound room. And if you are in a regular habit of doing it in a systematic way, the way you want to take it, you will miss, there is less likelihood that you are going to miss the anomalies. So what should be the stepwise or systematic approach? Take a history, then do a general survey of the womb. Like, you have to first see number of fetuses, the lie of fetus, cardiac activity is present or not, and ascertain the situs of the fetus. At the very onset, when you are doing a generalized survey, then do a biometry. The routine biometric like measurements we take: head circumference, biparietal diameter, abdominal circumference, femur length, then atrial width, transcerebral diameter, cisterna magna, and other parameters we should measure as per the need, what we ascertain from the scan. If there is if we see that the long bone is falling short, like femur length or humerus length is falling short in less than third percentiles, then try to measure all the long bones. So you have to see what you want to measure. And like, if you feel that the cardiac position looks abnormal to you, then measure the cardiac excess. If cardiac size appears larger, then measure the cardiac size, and accordingly you measure it. Then perform your targeted imaging. Look for the fetal activity, like fetal movement, fetal breathing movement you can see. Then see the fetal environment, like amniotic fluid. If you feel that amniotic fluid is less, do AFI measurement. See the placenta. See the cord insertion, whether the cord is centrally inserted or peripherally is inserted, or if it is the velamentous insertion. Look for vasa previa. Look, put a color at the internal os. You can see if the any like a cord, if it is moving in front of the like os, you can pick it up. But only if you are in a habit of doing it. Then see the internal os, whether internal os is closed. See for the cervical length. If you can see the os is open, see for whether the membranes are funneling, whether it is C-shaped membranes. You can pick up so many things, but always develop this habit. Ideally, we should do a transvaginal approach for assessing the os internal os status. So then see for a generalized survey of the uterus, if there is any fibroid, and in the adenexa, if there is an ovarian mass, ovarian cyst, you see all and document it as we do in first trimester. Then there are various guidelines available by ISWOC, which provides a 20+2 approach, Australian Society for Ultrasound Medicine guidelines, FMF guidelines. Then we have American Institute of Ultrasound Medicine guidelines, and they have so many guidelines. Just stick to one, try and then follow that. Like, it is just for an example, I have highlighted this Australian Society guidelines, and it is a very elaborate guideline. If you follow this, there are less likelihood chances of missing up anomalies, because this is almost like a checklist. Like in head, you have to see for the fax, cavum septum pellucidum, skull bones, lateral ventricles, choroid plexus, cerebellum, nuchal thickness, cisterna magna. And face, the profile view you see for the orbits, hypo, you can rule out hypotelorism, hypertelorism, then and there. See the nose, see the jaw, the continuity of upper jaw, you can pick up cleft palate. Look for the continuity of the lips, can pick up, rule out cleft lip, nasal bone you have to see, and you have to see the profile view, microgonathism, we can really pick up at this time if we are in a habit of looking at the face. Then see the diaphragm, continuity of diaphragm, heart, cardiac activity, position, axis, and always we have to see four chamber view, LVOT, RVOT, three vessel view. Then in heart itself, look for the continuity of interventricular septum, opening of foramen, oval, mitral valve and tricuspid valve, offset of the, both the valves, then their valve movements we have to see. Then in the abdomen, we have to ascertain the stomach, the situs, both the kidneys should be visualized, bladder should be visualized, and abdominal wall, whether there is a deficiency in abdominal wall at the level of cord insertion, we have to see. Then spine, we evaluate in the sagittal view, coronal view, and axial view. I'll show you with the examples. Then we have to see for the continuity of the skin above it. And in extremities, all the long bones, all the four segments, we have like three segments of all the four limbs we have to see. Hands and fingers, feet and toes, like umbilical cord insertion in abdomen, three vessel view we have to see. Three vessel we can ascertain when we see the umbilical cord. Then amniotic fluid, placenta, its site, distance from the internal os, placental myometrial interface. This is important, like if a placenta is low lying or it is placenta previa, and we see a translucent zone behind the placenta, and we have to rule out placenta percreta or accreta. If we see that, we can sometimes pick it up. In cervix, we see for the cervical length, open or closed, and maternal anatomy. So it is such an elaborate list. If we follow it regularly, then we can definitely pick what is abnormal, that it is not looking normal, then we refer that patient. ISWOC, very common approach, which is very common and very popular, and usually we follow this. So it is basically two overviews and 20 plane approach. If we follow, like if we take 20 images, almost we can pick 50 abnormalities by this following this approach. Like it has all spine, we see spine in three views, sagittal, complete spine with skin covering, coronal complete spine, coronal section of the body, head, we see transventricular, transthalamic, transcerebellar plane, thorax, we see lung, two lungs with four chamber view of the heart, left ventricular outflow tract, right ventricular outflow tract, and crossover, three vessel trachea view of the heart. In the abdomen, we see what the transverse section of abdomen with stomach and umbilical vein, transverse section of abdomen at cord insertion, transverse section of both the kidneys. Then in pelvis, we see transverse section of pelvis, bladder, both umbilical arteries. Then on assessing the limbs, again, three planes, femur diaphysis length, three bones of both legs, both feet, and normal relationship to both the legs. Three bones of both arms, both hands, and normal relationship to both arms. Then on face, we see coronal view of upper lip, nose, and nostril, both orbit, both lengths, and median face profile. Then a second overview, which is a sweep, transverse sweep of body from neck to sacrum, one vertebrae at one time. So like if we follow this approach, we can find these many abnormalities in total 20 planes, means 50 abnormalities we can rule out if we follow this approach. And this is the list of abnormal appearances on doing this way. And you can very easily find this on the net. Like anencephaly and IUD on the first longitudinal, if when we are doing a first overview, we have to see the cardiac activity, we can rule out IUD. When we are seeing the scanning the baby, if the head is not visible, anencephaly, we can definitely rule out. Then when we are seeing the spine, we can rule out, pick up abnormal abdominal situs, left sided diaphragmatic hernia, meningocele. This is a big list. We can you can go about it on the net. And if anything is abnormal, we have to refer that baby. So when do we, what are the criteria for referral? Any appearance which is not normal. When we are evaluating the head, if the posterior horn of lateral ventricle is more than 10 millimeter, means if there is a ventriculomegaly. If the BPDHC is outside the normal range of size chart, and if on assessing the abdomen, if the abdominal circumference is outside the normal range, if there is renal pelvic calectasis, if the size of the renal pelvis is more than 7 millimeter on AP diameter, on limb evaluation, if the femur length falls outside the normal range. So what is the key point? In by ISWA guidelines, working through the two overview planes and 20 plane in the described sequence, it provides a logical and time efficient examination of the whole fetus. Examining the fetal anatomy correctly is more important than the order in which it is assessed. Your role is to distinguish between the range of normal and abnormal appearance of the mid-trimester fetus. Any appearance which you cannot confirm as normal should be referred for a more experienced opinion. So these are the images like given by the ISWOG. You can take them as a chart, like or a four-chamber view of the heart, RVOT, LVOT. This is the head transcerebellar image, transventricular image. Then these two lungs with the four-chamber view showing the mitral valve, tricuspid valve. You can see the offset. I'll show you, these are the book images. I'll show you my images also, that the images you will get from your machine. So just see this. We take three images, three planes of the head. This is a transventricular plane. I hope it is visible to all. What all things you have to ascertain that you have taken a correct image. You see the complete view of the head. There is no deficiency in the skull bone. Then the cavum septum pellucidum is visible in the in at the junction between one third up, anterior one third and posterior two third. And we see this lateral ventricle posterior horn, this lateral ventricle, and we have to measure the atrial width at the level of parieto-occipital. This, can you see this parieto-occipital sulcus? At this level, we should measure the ventricular atrial width. Okay, if this width is more than 10 millimeter, then we say it is ventriculomegaly. Okay, in this section, you should also visualize the lateral sulcus. There are this like this. The lateral sulcus changes its shape with the period of gestation. And we should be aware of the normal shape at each gestation so that we can assert, rule out size and cephaly. Okay, this is transventricular plane where we measure the biparietal diameter and the head circumference. Now, this is the transthalamic plane where we see both the thalamus. Okay, again, in this view, we should be seeing cavum, septum, pellucidum in this view. Now, if we now be coming to the transcerebellar plane, again, in an accurate transcerebellar plane, you should be seeing cavum, septum, pellucidum and the cerebellum. And again, the lateral sulcus or the sylvian fissure. And here we see, this is the cisterna magna, which should be measured. And then we have to measure the nuchal thickness from the outer part of this bone to the outer part of the skin. Okay. Here, today only I saw this baby and I had this pick up this abnormality. I just wanted to show you that. Can you think, do you think that this is normal, which I showed you? The head is slightly compressed. Maybe this is because the baby was, it was 17 weeks pregnancy with the severe oligoamnios. Okay, though I could see this cavum, septum, pellucidum, but the anterior horn, this shape of the anterior horn is not normal. It looks like a staghorn appearance of a staghorn. Horns of a stag antelope, which are curved anteriorly. They are concave medially. Normally, it should be like this. It should be convex medially and it should be in this shape. So there is some abnormality in this, in the brain. So when we come to the spine, we have to assess it in all the three planes. Sagittal plane, we see for the, I'll show you. You have to see the spine in totality and we have to see the sacral tapering of the spine and we see the skin covering over it. And when we see internally, you can see the cauda equina, the spinal cord ending here at S1, S2 level and cauda equina also. Okay. So when we come to the coronal plane, so it looks like a cone appearance. Huh? We see both the ischial bones. We see both the ischial bones. We see the tapering end of the spine. If there is anything abnormality, you will visualize it. But you should develop the habit of taking all the three views. This is a video. I am scanning this spine from sacrum to the tip. You can see completely what we are supposed to see. We should be seeing the skin covering it in totality. Both the lateral rami, there is no gap in a rami. All the rami are visible and the skin in over above it is totally visible. So this is the way you are. Seeing the spine. Okay. Now coming to the abdominal scans, I'm going according to the ISWOG guidelines. Okay. So we are seeing abdomen in the three planes. We have to measure abdominal circumference and it should be the correct plane we should choose. We should be seeing single rib on both the sides. This is the stomach and this is the umbilical vein and it should be moving away from the stomach. It should be convex like this. Okay. And we measure the abdominal circumference at this plane. Aorta is like behind the stomach and IVC is in front and to the left, to the right of this aorta. Okay. And in the cord insertion, we are seeing the cord insertion and there is no defect in the abdominal wall. If there had been a defect, we can pick up this omphalocele or gastroschisis here. And then a third plane, showing both the kidneys with the renal pelvis. Kindly note the appearance of the kidney here. This is the normal kidney. And this is the scan of the baby, which I showed you the head, abnormal head. This baby had severe oligoamnia, so I was looking for the kidneys. So you can appreciate that both the kidneys are, this is a coronal plane and this is an axial plane. Both the kidneys are enlarged in size and they are hyperechoic. There is increased echogenicity and a little bit of dilatation of the pelvis is there. And the bladder was empty with this. So this could be the both bilateral polycystic kidneys. So this is an abnormal appearance. Just seeing this should raise your alarm. There is some problem somewhere. So again, if we assess the pelvis, we have to see normal bladder with the two umbilical arteries coursing running side by side of the bladder. We are seeing the spine here. We are seeing the ischial bones here. Then coming to the thorax, evaluation of fetal heart. So this is the four chamber view with the two lungs on each side. So what are you supposed to see? Aorta is always adjutting the left atrium. So left atria opens into the left ventricle. This is the mitral valve, right atria opening into right ventricle through the tricuspid valve. And they are not at the same level. There is some tricuspid valve is more apical. So there is an offset here and there is a moderator bend in the tricuspid valve. Okay, the valve, they follow the ventricles. They, and if we see this, we can all pick four chamber abnormalities here. And
just a moment, madam. I'll just make it an hour. Yeah, you please.
Yeah, she's unmuted.
And we should be seeing the pulmonary veins entering into the left atria. And coming on to the RVOT view, this is the aorta in the central right ventricle giving rise to the pulmonary artery, which is dividing into left and right. So this is the left ventricular outflow tract, or we can this left ventricle giving rise to the aorta. We have to see the aortomitral continuity. Okay, if there is a gap here, then we can pick up the ventricular VSTs here, or we can see the overriding of aorta as a in top. Okay. This is the coming to first this view. This is three vessel moving from left to right, pulmonary, aorta, and superior vena cava. And this is the trachea, three vessel trachea view. And if we see this, you can see that this is the three arch view, like not, this is the pulmonary vessel. This is the aorta, they are meeting here, but ductal arch, this is the aortic arch. Ductal arch and aortic arch, we can see meeting it each other. And like always develop the habit of seeing this view. Always divide your screen into two. See the stomach, where the stomach is on which side, and see the heart is on the same side. Though it is not always that it is always, if in total situs inversus, again, we are seeing this, but always develop the habit of showing, dividing the screen into two and showing stomach and heart. Okay. And we should put color also to see that. Now coming to the facial profile view, the two orbits, we have to see with the lens, both the lens visible. We have to see the continuity of the palate, upper palate. We have to see the two nostrils, the upper lip, the lower lip, and the side view facial profile. Here again, we are seeing the nasal bone, the skin over it, the maxilla, the mandible, and the chin. So I'll again show as an example. This is again a image, yesterday only I took this. We could, if because I we developed this habit of seeing all the images, I could pick up this cleft lip. Okay, you can very well see there is a defect here in the upper lip. Okay, and I'll this, yes. And when the cleft lip was visualized, then I was looking purposely for, is there any cleft palate? Yes, we can see. Can you appreciate this deficiency in the palate here? So there is cleft palate also here. So when I do a 3D rendering of this image, we can very well see this cleft lip. Yes, and the tongue protruding out of this. So coming to the limbs, both the develop the habit of seeing all the four limbs. Even I have missed once. I just saw one lower limb. I thought everything is fine. But that baby had one lower limb missing, which was picked up at another, just 1 week later. I had called up for a follow-up. I could see the other limb, lower limb was missing below the knee. So always develop the habit of seeing all the limbs, not seeing just one limb and thinking that everything is fine. See fingers, all the five fingers of both the hands. Though it is difficult, but try to look for it. If you are not able to see, mention in your report. Measure the femur length. See the foot. If some needed, foot length has to be measured. We can measure the foot length. And these are the additional images I take, like always put colors. Do a Doppler, see the two inflow tracts. look, we can pick up regurgitations in this. We can pick up this interventricular septal defects. We can always pick up. We are seeing this left ventricular outflow tract. If there is a flow from here, we can pick up minor perimembranous VSDs here. Then three vessel tricuspid. Both the limbs should have the same color. We can pick up then. Sometimes if you are not able to see the kidney, see the coronal plane, look for the aorta and look for the perpendicular branches arising at the level of kidney. If we can see that, that means the kidneys are there. So this is an indirect sign. And now always develop the habit of seeing the uterine artery PI values to see if there is a high risk for preeclampsia. If it is there, then we can put her on Ecosprin 150 milligram prophylactic dose. So we can at least predict for preeclampsia, then always measure the fetal heart rate and then look at for the placental location, measure the distance from the internal os. So this is just an example of ISWA format to how to write the report. You can develop your own report. And just a checklist for the first trimester scan given by the ISWA, almost like a same scan. And there is no hard and fast rule. You can develop your own. If you are seeing any images, you just add on to the images. You and like in first trimester, seeing for the intact lips is not mandatory. It is optional, though ISWOG is putting up a new guidelines. Maybe next year we'll be seeing the new guidelines, but these the asterisk ones are the optional views. But I would suggest try to look for all the views if you can see that. This I had explained in the previous slides also, like how we are doing an anatomic survey from head to toe in first trimester. Look for the shape of the head, look for the continuity of the skull bones, look for the fac cerebri, intact fac cerebri, choroid plexus filling the entire ventricle with a little bit of cerebrum mental we are seeing. Then we are seeing the lateral ventricle also. Then we have to see the third ventricle. We have to see the developing fourth ventricle. We have to see the thalamus also. Like this is the two thalamus, aqueduct of Sylvius, and distance of aqueduct of Sylvius from the occipital bone. And we have to see the developing future cisterna magna also. And when we are seeing it is very difficult to evaluate spine at 12 to 13 weeks. So we have to look for indirect signs, which can help us raising suspicion for open neural tube defects like obliteration of intracranial translucency, alteration in brainstem to brainstem occipital bone ratio. If that is abnormal, then it should raise our suspicion that there can be a spinal abnormality. If you are not able to pick up right there, you can call her up after 1 week or 2 weeks or do a transvaginal scan then and there only. Then we have to see the thorax, though we cannot see both LVOT, RVOT or three vessel trachea view, but with good equipments, good machines, we can pick up with them, or we can use a transvaginal probe. We can see all the four views, four chamber view, LVOT view, RVOT view, three vessel trachea view. Then cord insertion, we are looking in first trimester also, we are seeing the situs, we are looking for the bladder and umbilical artery, and we have to rule out omphalocele or gastrochiasis then and there only. And it is very easy to count the fingers in first trimester because baby hands are in open position. So otherwise that makes a fist in later part of the pregnancy. So we can count all the fingers. We can see for polydactyly, syndactyly, though we do not comment upon the club foot because there can be transient club foot in first trimester, but we can at least see all the three segments of four limbs. We can see the foot. So we have to see all this. And I think this was the last slide, and I would end with this because this in this presentation I have taken only the normal views. Maybe later, if you people want, we can take system-wise abnormal views, how to go about it systematically. Okay, thank you so much.
Yeah, Pratik.
Thank you, doctor.
Thanks, ma'am. And so wow. It's a soap grips, na? Yeah, I think you started in a bang time, and we have finished with the our time limit only.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot, madam. And we have in a series, madam. We have our third. We are planning in month of September.
Okay.
Yeah. Thanks
maybe,
a lot.
Maybe in the third week of September we can plan it.
Yeah, yeah, madam. Third week of September. Okay. Thanks a lot to all doctors who has joined.
Any thank questions? Do they have? If they have any questions, I would answer. Pratik,
you just ask if anyone have any question. No?
As of now, there is no question in chat box. If any doctors having any questions, please share. So accordingly, I will unmute them.
So I hope I have been clear. Maybe next time, if something else need to be asked, answered, please let me know.
Yeah, yeah, madam.
Yes.
Okay. So.
Okay, ma'am.
Thank you, Prati. Thank you, Pankaj. Yeah. Okay. You, bye. Good night.
Yeah. Good night. Yes. Okay.